Okay, here we go. Stand by. 3, 2, 1, action.
Assume nothing.
Rash, bald-faced blasphemy.
Question everything.
I find it extremely hard to imagine.
Open your eyes.
It is quite all right to be an atheist.
The fastest growing group of people in the country has been measured as being those who have no belief or who are atheists.
You don't have to be apologetic or quiet about it.
Challenge the opposition.
You see religion on 100 fronts losing the argument.
And start thinking. This is The Thinking Atheist Worldwide.
Tonight's show is sponsored by Nature Box. They've become a long-standing partner of this show. It's been great to have them, shipping great-tasting, healthy snacks right to your door. Forget the vending machine. You can start snacking smarter with healthy, delicious treats like dark cocoa almonds. Support this show. You get a free Nature Box sampler box. Just go to naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. I'm on a plane on Friday heading to Orlando, Florida for the Free Flow 2014 event, the Florida Free Thought Convention. Dr. Lawrence Krauss is going to be the keynote out there. October the 18th, I'll be at Wichita State University for the Skeptics of Oz event, and then SkeptOcon at the University of Central Oklahoma in Edmond, October the 25th. All the details on those upcoming events at the events page at thethinkingatheist.com. Before we get underway with our special guest, and he is a very special guest, I'm excited always to hear the stories of people who've been on the front lines of religious belief, preaching and teaching and proselytizing and all of that, and often after decades of investment, you know, all in, 100% investment, they do sort of a reevaluation and decide, hey, wait a minute, maybe I was wrong. And then they publicly tell the people in their congregations, all that stuff I preached, I don't believe anymore. I mean, those are fascinating stories. And we're going to hear another one of those stories here in just a few minutes. And I'm really excited about sort of taking that journey. But first, there are a few things floating around the web that I really want to talk about. And one of those, obviously, is the manufactured controversy about this Carrie Underwood song. Now, if you're not familiar with Carrie Underwood, as I understand it, she was an American Idol winner, and she's a hugely popular country recording artist, and she's got a song called Something in the Water. And so all these online sort of conservative tabloids all of a sudden post a story that says this. In fact, I'm looking at one at a place called tellmenow.com. I think The Blaze also picked this up. The headline says, Atheists Outraged by Carrie Underwood's Latest Song. The article says, Carrie Underwood's a good old country girl with a heart of gold and the voice of an angel. In her new song, Something in the Water, she proved that she's also a child of God by singing about her faith. In the song, Underwood sings about baptism and being washed in blood, which refers to the blood of Christ. The whole message is we humans are lost without God. Atheists are outraged that such a hit maker as Underwood would dare to sing about Christianity, but Carrie doesn't seem to care. Now I'll stop there. You and I as atheists hear this story and we go, what Carrie Underwood song? Bunch of people said, who's Carrie Underwood? And anybody familiar with country music is not at all surprised by the promotion of God in the lyrics of the song. Country music is. It's God, it's guns, it's pickups, it's beer. That's country music. And God is one of those things that's always in there. Thank the good Lord. Country artists are thanking the good Lord about everything. Thank him for your family. Thank him for your country. Thank him for that pretty sunset. You thank him for our freedoms here in America. God is a constant in the genre of country music. And so the idea that atheists hear one song and have a shit fit is just ridiculous. And so you and I look at each other and we think, well, what are these people talking about? Well, this is obviously just another way for those who hold to a deity to play victim, to say, we're persecuted, they're coming after us, but we're going to stand firm and stand together. We're going to see a whole lot more of this in the coming weeks as we once again have to endure the war on Christmas, the non-existent war on Christmas, right? Where Christmas is everywhere, and yet on Fox News every 5 minutes, they talk about those atheists trying to steal Christmas and steal our joy, and they're trying to suck the marrow out of our lives and to rob us of our faith. They hate Jesus. So we have to go through months and months and months of that. I read a blog. It was by a Paul, I believe it's pronounced Leiby, L-O-E-B-E, on Patheos. He had a great line. He said, Carrie Underwood fans have recently been on a tirade bashing atheists for allegedly bashing her for singing about Gasp Jesus. Imagine that. A privileged Christian white woman from a predominantly privileged Christian white culture has released a song praising the predominant religious figure of her own religious preference, which falls in line with 70% of the nation's citizens. Imagine that. Anyway, to see everybody frothing at the mouth on social media about this, religious people are saying, we'll show those damn atheists. We'll sing about our God and we'll be washed in the blood. Can I get an amen? It just boggles the mind. Something else that has been boggling the mind lately was a video recently released by Prager University, hosted by Peter Kreeft, the professor of philosophy at Boston College. And this short video, well-produced, essentially sort of did a retread of the tired and long-addressed and long-debunked arguments of misinformation about cosmology, the Big Bang, intelligent design, morality, all those things. And Aaron Raw produced and posted a response to this video called Theism is Not Rational. Now, there's a lot of wonderful information, a lot of great response videos, a lot of good material out there from channels like Aaron's and so many others. And it's rare that I'll stop and say, watch this video, please. Take the time to absorb this response. But I'm doing it now. In fact, when I saw this, I immediately posted on the Thinking Atheist social media pages, and I sent Aaron a special personal email, and I said, you are amazing. Thank you for putting this out. Rarely have I seen this misinformation, these wrong-headed claims about intelligent design so succinctly put down. He did such a good job on his response video. I think it's helpful to those of us who are in discussions with creationists in our own circles and in the arena of debate and ideas. And I really think our audience will enjoy and benefit from it. So I'm going to put the link in the description box of this podcast. Let me encourage you, man. Take 16 minutes and watch Aaron Raw's video, Theism is Not Rational. He knocked it out of the park and it is still going. My special guest in just a second, but first a huge thank you out to tonight's show sponsor, it's Nature Box. Two words from Nature Box on tonight's show that you got to remember. Free snacks. It's the chance to get free snacks. Drop the candy bar, drop the potato chips, drop all that stuff you get out of the vending machine. It's not good for you. You can get delicious, wholesome snacks from Nature Box. And I mean really good stuff. I'm not just making this up. In fact, I'm getting messages from people in our audience who are trying this stuff out. They're saying, hey, you're right. I mean, it's really good. You don't have to feel guilty about them. They're better for you. Zero artificial flavors, colors, or sweeteners. Zero trans fats. No high fructose corn syrup. You'll find snacks with no added sugar. There are gluten-free options and a whole lot more. You can try Nature Box snacks like cinnamon swirl kettle kernels and pumpkin spice nom noms and Santa Fe corn sticks and PB&J granola, barbecue kettle kernels, pistachio power clusters, over 100 more to choose from, and you can try them for free with a trial box that has 5 of their most popular snacks. So try it. Free snacks. To get your free trial underway, go to naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. Stay full, stay strong, snack smarter. naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. My special guest tonight was a minister for over 3 decades, with about 15 of those years as senior minister at Metropolitan United Church, one of the most prominent churches of the United Church of Canada. He wrote a syndicated column which discussed religion and religion-based topics for 25 years. Now, September 26th of this year, he announced to the world in his column that he no longer believed in God. And he is releasing a new book which chronicles his journey. It's called Life Beyond Belief, A Preacher's Deconversion. He was kind enough to join me for today's broadcast. Bob Ripley, thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure, Seth.
Always fascinating to hear the stories of people who've sort of done this 180. And I have to start at the beginning in your case. Were you born into a religious home?
I was. I was born in an Anglican or an Episcopalian tradition, right? I was in church 9 months before I was even born. And, you know, went through as a choir boy, Sunday school teacher, a server, which is kind of a Protestant equivalent of an altar boy. So, yes, grew up in a very devout home.
The church was really part of the fabric of your upbringing. Everywhere you went, you guys did Christian stuff. Would that be an accurate way to say it?
Yeah, it was basically a life revolved around church and home. I played guitar, and I sort of wanted to introduce guitar, modern music, into the church, and Jesus was the quintessential hippie, you know, with the long hair and the sandals and talking about peace and challenging power. But it didn't go very well, and I kind of left that and went into another church up the road, and they welcomed me with open arms, and I became part of a Christian band and actually got converted through that experience.
What did you play in the band, or were you the vocalist?
No, I was, vocals and guitar.
I just picture you out there wailing, you know, like fist in the
air. No, those are really headed Jesus movement times, early 70s.
So we're talking, the Larry Norman era, you know, that kind of thing?
Well, a little, end of Larry Norman, second chapter of Acts, then Phil Keaggy and all that sort of stuff. So I got to tour with Phil Keaggy for a while. So I was really, I said I had my conversion experience there and through music and performing and so on. And then I just felt that this was, ministry was what I was supposed to do. So then I went into the sort of mainstream of a denomination here in Canada called the United Church of Canada, which is sort of like United Methodist in the States, and became ordained in 1977 and then spent the next 35 years in ministry.
I got to go back. You toured with Phil Keaggy?
For a while.
You're hanging out with Keaggy?
I did hang with Phil Keaggy for a while. Sorry. You know,
the
name dropping, but
It's funny. I'm doing a presentation around the country called The Copycats, where we talk about a lot of the things that Christian culture does to sort of play on what's popular in pop or secular culture.
Uh-huh.
You know, we see a certain genre of music, a certain style, a certain thing that's big in quote-unquote secular culture, and you'll wait a few months and you'll see a Christian equivalent.
Yeah.
And but we were talking about some Christian artists, and you know, Phil Keaggy remains one of the premier guitar players on planet Earth today.
Absolutely, without question.
Just a brilliant talent. And I know Christian music takes a lot of heat out there.
Well, it does. So, it does.
Yeah.
But he's a nice guy to boot, you know, and has remained a Christian, you know, through the years, and managed to have a wonderful musical career.
Yeah. So you felt called. I feel called. I want to be a minister. Was it preaching, or was it, I'm going to do something else? Or did you know?
Well, no, I think it was preaching. I think when I started to get up there with my guitar and tell my story, I just felt that this was sort of what I was supposed to do. Before that, I really had no idea what I was going to do with my life. And so, you know, I'm 19 years old. I'm 20 years old. And so into the stream of ministry, I leap.
And mom and dad have to be hugely proud at this moment, right?
They were proud. No, they were all, I mean, I left the church of my birth, so to speak, into a different stream of Christianity. But no, they were always supportive of me. I've been very fortunate in the course of my life to have a supportive family, both my parents to now my kids. So,
our son is preaching the word out there. Or were they that devout? I mean, did they take their faith that personally?
No, I wouldn't call them sort of evangelical in their faith, more mainline Protestant, but very proud that I was doing good work out there.
So what, seminary? I mean, what was your path in?
Yeah, path in was seminary, undergrad degree in London, Ontario, and then on to Toronto for my MDiv, and into then ordination in 1977.
What's the culture in Toronto church-wise? I mean, are they passive? Is it heavily Christian?
Well, I guess I would, rather than talking about Toronto, I think, in, you know, Canada as a country is overall, I'd say, more secular than the U.S. But, you know, there are certainly pockets of evangelical churches. The mainline Protestant churches and Catholic Church as well, you know, have been on a kind of a gradual decline over the last 30 years.
Aren't you guys always in battle as far as the influence of Catholicism in the schools, Catholic school, that type of thing? Isn't that a continuing fight up there?
It's a continuing battle because our you know, the public funding of separate schools, Catholic schools, raises its head every once in a while. And especially as the population, as the baby boom generation moves along and there are fewer kids and schools are having to close. So it's not just churches that are closing, but schools are closing too. So there's some tension between the public funding of separate schools and the fact that it's written in our Constitution that there is allowance for the funding of Catholic schools.
By the way, you don't have to go too far to be less religious than the United States. You know, it's rampant.
Yeah.
It's rampant here.
I appreciate that. And I'm sure, and I've read many of the stories through the Clergy Project, of which I've been a member for a couple of years, that it's horrific for people in general, but of course for clergy to come out as an atheist, the experience can be gut-wrenching.
Talking here with Bob Ripley, he's the author of a new book called Life Beyond Belief, A Preacher's Deconversion. Do you remember the day that you first took the pulpit or stage as sort of the head of a flock, the head of a church, as senior minister?
I can't honestly remember my first sermon. I remember my first sermon at the church that I served for 50 years before I took early retirement, which was Metropolitan United Church here in London, because it was the largest mainline Protestant church in Canada. And I was scared out of my mind that I had been given this opportunity at that time, as I saw it, to be in a prominent pulpit in Canada. So that I remember very well, being scared out of my mind. But anyway, but I always appreciated, I guess, what one of the things that church did for me was to pull the best out of me as a public speaker, and because the people brought to church such great expectations and anticipation, so that you needed to have some good stuff there for them. I always appreciated that part of being a preacher. But back in the early days, I mean, I think we were just sort of talking about giving our testimony, talking about our faith. I started off at a little country church, you know, one Sunday one person showed up, so, you know, that small, right? And when you said, dearly beloved, the organist blushed, you know, that sort of thing.
Yeah, you get one salvation, you've got 100% conversion rate.
Absolutely, yeah, the numbers were great back in those days.
There's a theater, I think, to being a pastor, isn't there? I mean, it's not just having the information. You've got to be able to entertain, to compel, to teach, to do all these things at the same time, yes?
Oh, worship is drama. It is putting together the different elements of music and spoken word and the physical space. Yeah, all these things sort of work together. I often thought of worship as being, you know, high drama. I've also dabbled in the theater, and there's some interesting, fascinating parallels between live theater and worship. If you go to certain traditions in Christianity, you'd sort of begin to wonder about the authenticity, because sometimes there's, you know, but now we've got the lighting and sound and screens and so on that, yeah, becomes fascinating sometimes when all these elements come together and can easily be manipulated, obviously. But even without the intent of manipulation, there is theater in it, as there is in Scripture.
The two words that come to my mind are conditioned response. I heard someone who was a drummer in a worship band at a local church, and he said that he believed that the way you could strike a cymbal could affect whether someone has sort of a quote-unquote spiritual experience. Mm. How you lower the lights, where the lights are placed, where the instruments are placed, the cadence of the person speaking, what they're wearing. You know, I mean, there's so many things that sort of bring people closer into this, for lack of a better way of saying it, this sort of spiritual encounter, this highly emotional type of encounter. And church is quite good at providing those types of environments, and people seem to be hungry for them.
Oh, yes, I agree wholeheartedly. I mean, even I remember with the band zone, you want to, and music, you want to adjust the tempo, the tone of the music. So as you say, to bring it sort of up loud, now you bring it down quieter before the word is spoken, and then you end up with the big high at the end. not to suggest that that, again, sometimes, to be honest, the intent is sincere. The intent is to create an experience for people that will be meaningful, that will create a spiritual experience for them, which, again, at that time, I would have said the intent was good. The intent was positive. You wanted these people who had come to worship to leave with a powerful experience.
I'm glad you said that. A lot of people immediately say, the church wants to manipulate you to get your 10% at the offering plate.
Yeah.
And I think that's a huge misrepresentation. In my experience in the church, it was, how do we create a moment where the Spirit can move? And it was a sincere desire to not hinder any opportunity for God to work in someone's life. So how can we enhance the experience and open those doors even wider? So
yes.
And you sort of become embedded in the church as the senior minister, and you're a syndicated columnist, is that right?
Yes, I've been writing for a weekly column for over 25 years now.
What do you write about?
Well, for most of those years, the column was called In Other Words, and I used to say I was trying to get the Christian message out in words other than a sermon. So it would be topical, it would be, you know, a way to sort of, in 500, 600 words, just a little somewhat devotional material. So I was the religion columnist in the Saturday paper for many years.
Were you targeting like a fundamentalist, or are you kind of looking for those people who are seekers out there who are sort of on the outer membrane?
I was writing for the person who didn't go to church.
Wow.
And I always found it high praise when somebody said to me, I don't go to church, but I never miss your column. Because I was really trying to get that person I come at the biblical story in a kind of a wacky angle and try to get the message out from a different platform, pre-internet platform of the print media. So I think I have a wacky enough sense of humor that I could present the Christian message in a way that would be attractive to those people who didn't come to church on that Sunday, and had all a good response from that. But then in the last 2 years, of course, I began to shift the tone of the column from homily to commentary because of what's going on inside of me.
Were you a Bible literalist? Were you all in, absolutely literal, perfect, inerrant?
No, I come still from a fairly left-of-center liberal position theologically.
So how did you approach, like, Garden of Eden, Noah's Ark, those types of stories?
Well, certainly the Adam and Eve, I always said, you know, it doesn't really matter whether they exist or not. The point is the message that we're separated from God. The biblical story, you know, their ark and Jonah and the whale, I never tried to say, well, this really happened or this really didn't happen. It was metaphor. What's the message here? That was the essence of my preaching, is what's the message in Scripture, not whether it actually happened historically.
So it could be literal, it could be an example, parable, but the ultimate thing is that we look at the larger picture of what's the story trying to tell us?
Yes, I mean, that's the essence of my preaching, because I don't think that people come to church to sort of hear an argument of whether, you know, how did all the animals on the earth get into an ark in Turkey. I think they're there to say, is there a message for me in my struggles this coming week? So the pastor's heart in me really didn't care to talk about the historicity of the Scriptures, but the message of the Scriptures.
Most people who come to your congregation, do you think they were simply scratching the community itch? Is there any merit to that?
There is merit to that. I think, again, people come to church for a variety of reasons, and that's certainly one of them, that people find connection with others.
Did you guys have like a welcome ministry? Did you have specific sort of guidelines for how we greet people, how we welcome them, what we say, what we give them, do we call afterwards?
Oh, yeah. We try very hard to, you know, if a stranger walks in the door, you know, that they're made to feel welcome and everybody's welcome here. You know, try to get people afterwards to engage, get them to the coffee hour, you know, the stranger is welcome. It's a constant battle, but something that we always strove to create. I mean, why else are we here, right? But
I'm talking here with Bob Ripley. I want to get into your deconversion here in just a second. Let's talk first, though, about the vulnerable in the church. Now, the church is very good at hyper-targeting those who are at very difficult points in their life. They've got divorce recovery. They've got programs. Some churches have some for people who are non-heterosexual. We're going to pray away the gay thing. We're going to bring you in and show you God's true model for healthy sexuality. abuse, drug abuse, physical abuse. You know, there seem to be all these programs in place designed to sort of be a net that those who have been damaged in their life fall into, or who don't fit a certain mold will sort of walk into. Did you guys do some of that kind of thing?
We did some of what you talked about here, like divorce recovery, recovery from addictions. We didn't get into, obviously, praying away the gay. That's just not part of our mindset. But, you know, you try to provide programs for people, the vulnerable and the hurting. So, again, that, to me, that's all part of the package of community that you provide. It's not just a welcome on Sunday, but is there, you know, are you, do you have a particular need? How can we meet that need? So we would offer those kinds of programs selectively, meaning try to pick out the ones that people would respond to the most within our culture and context.
I understand that it's often done for sincere reasons. We want to help those who have been damaged by Satan. But now that I'm on the other side of the looking glass, I look at it as, I hate to say the word preying on the vulnerable, but I feel like in some ways it's sort of preying on the vulnerable. They are taking people who are at a valley in their lives, a very low point, and they're saying, here, come here, have a seat. We'll feed you physically, spiritually. We'll be your solution. These people who may be desperate, seeking an answer, the church is right there with sort of the, you know, they've got their claws out kind of thing. Do you want to speak to that at all?
Well, Seth, I guess I might push back a little bit because there are contexts in which people basically would prey on the vulnerable and say, well, here's a chance to get a new member, to boost our numbers. But in my experience in ministry, I found for the most part, it really was a sincere attempt to provide help to people that need it. You know, this last church I served, we had a hospitality meal, which was like hot meal on a Friday night. Anybody can come and get a hot meal, right? So we got 150 people every Friday night, just come and have a hot meal. There was no grace said, no tracts were handed out. Oh. It was just a meal. So I would speak for those people who do just want to do good without strings attached. But I'm sure that there are, on the other hand, lots of places where the people who have a desperate need are considered, you know, potential new members. So let's get them in.
Yeah. I remember there was a church downtown that would take a bus out and pick up all these impoverished kids, teenagers. Their parents would just put them on the bus and they would go to church and they would feed them. They'd feed them a great big breakfast, but only after they listened to a sermon from a children's pastor, a very literal Bible sermon. And something about that always rubbed me the wrong way. It's like, we'll feed you physically. Look at all these goodies over here. But first, here's the message of our Lord and Savior. Escape hell, receive Jesus, go to heaven, those types of things.
And it always, the urban equivalent of the rice Christians, right?
Yeah.
You know, here's a bowl of rice.
Yeah.
And we have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior.
We know even Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, right? He feeds them physically before he feeds them spiritually. I mean, I guess there's a biblical basis for that. Meet their physical need, and then you're able to meet them spiritually in some way. I guess there's a biblical foundation for that. Let's talk about doubt. You're a pastor, you're a senior minister, you're the man, right? You're out there preaching God's word, and what happened to you?
Well, my journey is, you know, just like journeys to faith are circuitous, so is my deconversion circuitous. But there are a number of signposts along the path, and that's really what the book is about, to take each signpost and kind of break it down and talk about it in great detail. We don't have that opportunity here. But there were a couple of initial moments that I can remember, and I'm going back about 7 years when I'm still in active ministry. One of them was, we would have the responsive reading of Psalms. So I read a verse, the congregation reads a verse, and back and forth. And I remember one particular Sunday where we're reading a psalm where God is sort of asked to be the hitman, to be the, you know, the mafia boss, and, you know, take out the enemy for me. And again, for reasons I have no logical explanation, but somehow that began to sit with me the wrong way. And I know you can say, haven't you ever read that psalm before? And I'm sure that I have. But for some unexplainable reason, it just started to hit me. And then I started to read other psalms, like right through to the end. And, you know, Psalm 139, which begins, you know, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat and wept when we remembered Zion, the people in exile. And then you read to the end of Psalm 139, And it says, how blessed will be the one who takes the children of the Babylonians and smashes their heads against the rock. And again, thinking, you know, in our context, if someone was to take a little girl and bash her head against the rock, we would hunt down this homicidal maniac, have them tried, incarcerated. But in this context, that person would be blessed by God. And it was sort of like, what? Yeah. And it kind of went on from there. And so I began to read the Bible seriously. I began to read it more thoroughly, I think, than ever before. And all these stories started popping out. All this God that I had been worshiping and adoring almost all my life became a despicable deity.
Bob, how were you reading it before? Was it just complete deference because he is God, or were you sort of skipping over the more unpleasant parts?
I think it was a bit of both. I think that I've always been aware of some of the little wacky parts of the Bible, but it's like, well, just, you know, skip over those and get to the good stuff, because I probably just didn't want to deal with it. But so many people recently, since I've sort of come out, have said, well, when you were in seminary, didn't you learn about the inconsistencies in the Gospels? And, you know, and my only answer is, you know, I think I did learn about them, but I really said, as I look back, I think I wanted to get out into the trenches of ministry so bad. It was like, don't bother me with this stuff. Just get me my degree. I want to get out there and preach the gospel. So I encountered some of the arguments about scripture and inconsistencies and so on. I never paid all that much attention to it because I wanted to get out into ministry.
So you went back to what, the book of Genesis 1:1, and you just started all over and read it from scratch? Or what was your process?
I don't know. I didn't start with Genesis 1 and start reading through. I just started reading excerpts, reading Psalms, reading the prophet Hosea, you know, where he says, you know, the Sumerians have turned away from their God. Their young children will be killed and their pregnant women will be ripped open. And it was like, huh?
Yeah.
It's like, so... And speaking as honestly as I can, I just started encountering passages of the Bible that for some reason I'd never encountered before. Another initial signpost was I was in an airport in Calgary, Alberta, in Western Canada, to visit my daughter, who was pregnant at the time. And for some unexplainable reason, I saw this yellow book. It was called God Is Not Great. And I bought it. I had never heard of Christopher Hitchens before, and I just bought it, and I read it on the plane back. And, of course, with his strident rhetoric was a bit of a shock to the system.
Yeah.
But he started making sense. It made sense to me. Those are sort of two initial moments that I can recall, the reading of some of the scripture passages in this yellow book by Christopher Hitchens.
So now inside your brain, you've got all sorts of sort of conflicting tides. And I'm reminded of the scripture out of James, you know, when you ask, you must believe and not doubt. The one who doubts is like a wave of the sea.
Yes.
He's a feather in the wind. In fact, what was the scripture that said, those who doubt can expect to receive nothing from the Lord? I think of doubting Thomas. Blessed are those who have not seen and believed. You are doubting. And are you starting to go through that? Wait a minute, there's something wrong with me. Did you have any of that going on?
No, it wasn't that there's something wrong with me. I've always been a curious guy. I've always been inquisitive. I've always been open to ideas. At least I think I've always been open to ideas. And I would never, looking back, I would never have said I'm on the path to atheism. That would be it was the last thing on my mind. It was just like I just started thinking about issues and topics that I hadn't thought of before. I mean, I read The God Delusion, Richard Dawkins, and I started to get fascinated with cosmology and biology. How did we get here? And I started reading about the comparisons of other religions, you know, the dying and rising gods and Osiris and all these other deities in the history. And again, these are all signposts along the way, all different areas of disciplines of thought and learning. So there's the Bible that actually I have in front of me, as well as science and astrophysics, as well as I started to go back to my biblical criticism, looking at the canon of the Gospels and how the story of Jesus evolved from Mark through to John based on, you know, how old they were. I mean, I always knew there were differences because, you know, Mark has no infant narratives and no resurrection appearances. He's here in his gospel. But by the time you get to the gospel of John, we've got this full-blown cosmic Christ. And I sort of, again, I began to think of how, with the oral tradition, between the time when Jesus of Nazareth would have been crucified to when things would have been written down in a different language, i.e. Greek. And I remember thinking about this game we used to play in the schoolyard when I was a kid called Buzz, where, you know, you give a sentence to one, and we'd all sit in a circle. You give a sentence to one person, they would whisper it all the way around the circle. And by the time you got back to the front, the last person would say what they heard, and the two sentences would have nothing to do with one another. So again, I'm thinking logically, I'm thinking rationally. I'm going, well, of course the stories of the Jesus would morph and change over the years. It just made sense to me. After about 2 years of this, I knew I had to stop preaching. And to the congregation, I said, I'm taking early retirement because the fire has gone out of my belly and I need to stop. And that was the truth. I used that phrase, but looking back, it really, the fire had gone out of my belly. I was facing what we now know of as classic cognitive dissonance between what I was to be proclaiming and how I was not as convinced in my own mind and heart anymore. So I just knew I had to stop.
So you actually stepped up on stage and you told them, I'm not all in, I'm going to bow out.
Yes. I didn't say I didn't believe. I just said, sayonara, I'm out of here. I just need to retire.
Certainly the questions came, right? Did people come after you and say, hey, are you okay? Is there anything we can do? Do you just need a sabbatical? You just need some time? You get any of that?
Well, it would have been nice if I did, but I actually didn't.
They're like, bye, Bob.
No, see, okay, if you got to go, you got to go. No, I think some people maybe thought I was burning out, but I really, that wasn't the reason.
Well, before that time, how does one do sermon preparation if they are becoming less and less convinced that the sermons that are using the Bible are accurate? How did you get around that?
It gets harder and harder. You know, I still would have classified myself as a believer. I still knew how to preach. And I know that there are clergy out there now who do not believe at all, and they're still in active ministry because they know what the congregation expects, and they're delivering the goods because they have a mortgage and a young family. And my heart goes out to them because I don't know what I would have done if I'd had this crisis 20 or 25 years earlier. I was in my mid-50s. So I had the chance to say, you know, I'm just going to retire early, and it's been wonderful, and thank you so much. But to answer, get back to your question, it just got harder and harder.
I mean, are you doing like a humanist thing, like let's be better people, let's live more lives, let's make the world a better place kind of thing?
I'd have to go back, but I don't think I went that route. I still was proclaiming, I think, the gospel faithfully. It is hard to describe, but it was just the fire was going out. I just didn't feel like as passionate about it anymore.
You know, another former minister, Dan Barker, talks about the 2 years he spent where he just was racked with pain and guilt because he felt he was lying.
And yeah, I got to know him. Dan's got a nice blurb on my book. And
you guys have a lot in common. I mean,
he said our stories are very, he said, the way he put it was, Bob, our stories are the same except for the tongues. because we didn't speak in tongues in our tradition. So, yeah.
Well, you know, one thing that you and Dan both share, and I think I share with both of you, is that we have a compassion for religious people, for people who are true believers. It is easy for those on an opposing side of an argument to paint the other with character. And I'm not saying we don't have moments of being strong or even there are moments of ridicule or mockery of ridiculous beliefs. When it comes to human beings, to brand everybody as they're all delusional, they're all insane, they're all stupid, those types of things are hugely wrongheaded and hugely unfair. And I like that about Dan as well. He has a real compassion for those who are still deep in the faith, and he genuinely wants to help them.
When you've been there, and if you keep that in mind, what it was like to be a believer, and that you really... you know, I used to say, like many, that the people who didn't believe were atheists. They were lost. They were amoral. They were mean and cruel. And so if the last thing you want is to be that caricature, that mean and cruel and that kind of person. So
did you have that picture of the atheist when you were a believer? sort of the dark, rudderless, sad, pathetic person who's roaming the shadows out there of society kind of deal.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I did. They were like the Madeline Marie O'Hara. She was the enemy of the church. She was the enemy of faith.
Yeah.
For years. I'm dating myself now, but yeah, they were the enemy.
So you retire, you quote unquote retire. Mm-hmm. When does the word atheist become real to you? I mean, when do you finally just make the break?
Well, I just continued on the path, just buying books and listening to discussions on YouTube and doing my own research. I was sort of hungry to understand what was going on in my head. And I started to document and write down what I was learning, because I've always sort of done that. So I guess that the journey just sort of carried on. After I retired, of course, people still come at you and say, could you preach here? Could you do a funeral here? And I just said, no, thank you so much, but I've retired. I stopped. So I had enough, I had enough integrity to say, no, I'm done, period. So I kind of went into not quite seclusion, but basically just sort of dropped out of sight for probably two or three years anyway. I've been retired 5 years now, and I think about 2 years ago, I finally had to say, you know, I am an atheist. I just do not believe in a supernatural power that's listening to my thoughts.
Did you feel more alone? Did you feel empowered? Was it like, oh, this sucks, there's no God, or, hey,
no,
there's no God, I can live my life honestly?
Initially, I was thinking, I'm going to lose my friends if they find out. Initially, I thought that. And then, as time went on, I thought, I can't, in all integrity, take this little secret to my grave. I have to be authentic and let it be known. So then I began to write the book, continued to write the column, shifting the tone of the column to more of a commentary. And then 2 weeks ago, wrote the coming out column, and the book was launched the week after that.
After the coming out column, did they say, thanks for playing goodbye, or do you still get to write for them?
No, I write for a media organization called Sun Media. I used to be was with the Toronto Star Syndicate, and then I had been Sun Media, and I got a call, or an email rather, from the Sun Media guy within 15 minutes of when I sent my coming out column in, and I thought, oh dear, I'm toast. But he was great. He said, you're a good writer, you've got a voice, that it's important that you continue. He said, now we get a lot of backlash from some of the papers that carry my column, we may have to rethink it and move you into editorial. But I was greatly relieved that they said, no, you just carry on. So, and again, I don't really know what the future of the column is, but I said in my coming out column, I've been writing this, like I didn't just go to bed a believer last Tuesday and wake up an unbeliever. This has been going on for 7 years, and I've been writing this column, and you've been reading this column, and I'm still the same person. So I have still more that I think I can say and contribute. I'm just telling you what's really going on in my head. So for now, anyway, the column will continue.
Talking here with Bob Ripley, he is an ex-minister and author of the new book called Life Beyond Belief, A Preacher's Deconversion, which, by the way, I will link in the description box of this show. Don't allow me to delve too deeply into your personal circle, but I must ask, you have a family at this measure, and what are they thinking? Are they a little traumatized? What's happening to Bob? He's changing. Any of that going on?
Well, good question. My kids, preacher's kids, bless them, pardon the pun, when they got to be 16 years old, it was basically, we're out of here, that they sort of stopped going to church. And I mean, it was my son, who's now 31, who actually, we were having lunch one day, and I realized he knew his Bible better than I did. He said, well, Dad, what about the passage in Deuteronomy, which says that if somebody entices you to other gods, that they should be killed? I went, really?
Wow.
So my kids, obviously, they're thrilled, if that's the right word.
So they're non-believers then, your children?
Yeah. They're non-believers.
Did they bolt because of the whole PK thing? I mean, preacher's kid, there's a stereotype to it, but there is some truth to it. I mean, there's a lot of pressure. You're sort of put in a box. You're always being talked
about. I've got three kids. They felt the pressure of being preacher's kids, but they, at the same time, I think, just had enough of... I mean, they're very great. They've said to me, Dad, were grateful for being raised in the church because of all the things that it gave them. And it did give them good things. It immersed them in a community and gave them opportunities. So we're grateful for being raised in the church, but obviously we don't believe anymore. My wife, again, we've sort of walked this path together. And my parents are deceased, so, I mean, I probably would have broken my mom's heart. Yeah. But she's not with us anymore, so.
You know, it's an interesting thing I often have seen for people who do a ministry type of work. They are often giving so much of themselves. Maybe this is true with any activist. You give so much of yourself to the cause. You know, you're busy preparing for the next presentation. You're busy being involved in this ministry, this outreach. You're there. You're always working. There's day and night. Phone calls are coming in the middle of the night, weekends, hospital visits, all those types of things. Mm-hmm. Quite often, it is a lifetime commitment. And many times, those in our inner circle often suffer because we are so committed to the cause. Did you find any challenges along those lines?
Well, in one of the early chapters in the book is Pilgrimage to the Pulpit, where I talk about that. And I admit that there were many, many nights when my kids didn't have a dad to tuck them into bed because people needed me. And I had meetings to chair. So the family does pay a huge price at times. And they did. And, holidays are timed around when it's best for me to be away from the church because in my context, I was the senior minister and I was expected to be in the pulpit every Sunday. And for the most part, I was. So we would time our holidays around when it was least disruptive for me to be away. So yes, family does pay a huge price. And sometimes there's bitterness there.
Yeah.
I don't sense bitterness from my kids. They really did appreciate all the good things that happened.
Bob, you ever miss preaching? Do you ever miss going up there and connecting with an audience, with a congregation?
I do miss that was the highlight of the week for me, was when I had written, mostly memorized, a 25-minute monologue, and I got up there to deliver it in this gorgeous, huge sanctuary. That was the high point of the week for me. So I miss that. I miss the church music. But I've also realized now that, I can download choral music onto my iPad or onto my Mac Air. And when I'm writing, I'll listen to some of the ancient medieval choral music, which I love. So there are ways to continue to have those elements that I at times miss. But now with the book now, I'm really opportunities for speaker coming in, obviously, and I enjoy speaking to an audience, and I'm really looking forward to being able to do that more often.
Now, there's nothing like seeing an ex-pastor turned atheist on stage doing his thing. Jerry DeWitt, every time Jerry DeWitt does his thing at a free thought event somewhere, mm-hmm. Everyone's sitting forward at the edge of their chairs, they're totally in. There's a storytelling element to science, to free thought, to skepticism, to looks at the claims of religion and whatnot. There's a storytelling aspect that I think that ex-ministers bring that is unique. I mean, how to sort of couch it so that it's not just a presentation of data points, bullet points, and facts, but you are taking people on a journey. I think you'd be terrific in front of a live audience in this capacity. So is that something we'll see? I mean, are we going to see you again?
We'll see. The very thought is enticing.
I mean, they would just love you to death. And, it's funny because I use many of these events in the free thought movement to sort of scratch the community itch. There are some who say that once you leave the church, any gathering, well, that's just an emulation of church. You're just cheating. You're borrowing the idea of the church. You're trying to be religious. But I've really come to the point where I think community is something that human beings need regardless. And when you leave the church, it leaves a huge hole in your life. Where do you go to get the hug, to get the handshake, to have someone ask about your life, about your day, to have the support groups? I mean, church does fulfill that role, and it's quite good at it.
It does, and that's, again, where shameless self-promotion alert, the last chapter of the book is Beyond Belief. It basically begins, where do we go from here? Where do I go from here? For people who have been immersed in church for a good part of their life and enjoyed it, so, okay, if we move out of that, so now where do we get community? Where do we get fed with music? Where do we go and hear a good talk that will stimulate our thinking and challenge our thinking? So that's one of the things that those of us who have left the church, I think, need to take seriously.
All right. So somebody's outside the door of one of those events and you're speaking and you've got your book and whatnot, and they're saying, you're a counterfeit, Bob. You were never a true believer to begin. No one who truly encountered Jesus Christ would have ever walked away from the faith. And they make that argument. How would you respond?
Well, I've already had people email me say, you know, you've never met the Heavenly Father face to face, obviously. At this point in time, I just sort of smile and nod my head. I mean, I can't. You don't know me. you don't know how sincere I was. You don't know how much of my life I gave to the gospel of Jesus Christ. You don't know me.
You were the genuine article.
I was the genuine article.
Did you ever have a moment in your life, Bob, when you felt the presence of God, or you felt that you felt the presence of God? Was it a, you know, was it an emotional experience? Was it goosebumps? Did you hear a voice? Did you think you met God at any point?
I think I met Jesus for sure when I was converted, when I was born again. I remember sitting in the pew. I remember thinking to myself, God, I really don't think I know you, and I want to know you. And I remember feeling there was a change in my life. There was a difference in my life. I can't deny that. I've never heard voices. but inside of me, I felt like this was a real experience for me. Again, I would underline the word experience, but it was a real experience for me.
Well, how do you explain it? Is it self-deception? Is it self-hypnosis? Is it sensory overload and you're feeling something that you really want to feel? I mean, how would you explain?
I think it's the latter, the last thing. I think it's something that you really, for me, it was something I really wanted. I've been steeped in the church to begin with, and I really wanted to have a personal encounter with God, and I had the personal encounter with God. So I wanted it, and I got it. I've been fascinated by, you know, the Michael Shermer's believing brain notions of, you know, how our brain works. But I think for me, it was something, you know, I wanted the experience. I got the experience, and it stuck with me for a long time.
What's the book supposed to do? I mean, are you trying to sort of tap religious people on the shoulder and say it's okay to have these types of questions?
The purpose of the book, as was the purpose of my preaching, to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. So the book.
I've got to steal that line, Bob.
Brilliant. Well, you've never heard that one before?
No.
No. So really, it is to comfort those people who think they're the only ones who are having these questions and doubts, saying you're not the only one. I'm up to about 200 emails in the last week and a half, and the vast majority of them have been people who said, thank you so much for putting into words what I've been wrestling with for a long time. So the pastor's heart in me just delights at this notion that I've provided some comfort from people who have been afflicted with skepticism and thinking, I don't know what to do with it. And at the same time, I hope that my book will afflict the comfortable, will provide some evidence, some arguments to people who are firm believers that they'll have to deal with if they haven't already dealt. And if they come out as a continuing to believe, that's fine. I'm not on a crusade to disabuse anyone of their faith. I simply want them, as I always have wanted people to think. So just think critically. And if you read my book and you still believe, then that's just fine. It's not like nobody's won or lost here. Like, people give their testimony in church about their conversion, and this is just one person's testimony of deconversion. And that's all it is. I'm just putting it out there. But I wanted to coincide with my column to say that I'm no longer a believer. I wanted to have a book that would detail all the reasons so that if somebody says, why somebody who has such a high profile in Canada, what would cause them to do the 180 and say, I'm no longer a believer? And I wanted to provide them with a means for them to understand, what would make me do that?
It's funny, on my own journey out of religion, it was a Canadian ex-pastor who helped me out. His name is Charles Templeton, and his book called Farewell to God, right?
Yes. A
prominent evangelist and pastor who sort of took the same journey that you did. I remember reading his book, and I was just nodding my head. I found myself relating to the doubts he had, the journey out of religion that he had so much, and it reassured me that it was okay to explore those questions. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like that's what you hope that life beyond belief will do for others as well.
gives them permission and the words. Sometimes you need, like, it was like, as I said, reading Christopher Hitchens, you know, as strong as he was the first person to kind of like whack on the side of the head, but it made me think.
Comfort the afflicted, afflict the comfortable. All right, I've got that written down. That's a new bumper sticker for the Xterra. Yeah.
I'll look for it on your website.
Okay. Bob, you're amazing and a tremendous pleasure to have on the radio. I'm excited for you. I'm excited for the book. If I see you on the conference circuit, I'm going to have you autograph it for me.
I'd be delighted, Seth.
I'm excited about that. And I will include the link. Is it available yet? I know here it's early October. It's coming out now. Is it already available?
It's available in Canada through Indigo Chapters. It's not on digital yet, but that's all to come soon enough. So if people may have to be a little patient.
Okay. All right.
Well,
what I'll do then is once it is released, I'll come back. And many of the people who listen to this show listen in archive well after the live airings, today being the 7th of October. I'm going to go back and put the link for that book in the description box of this show. So if you're listening after the fact, double check the description box. You should be able to link it directly when it is available here in the States. And if you're in Canada, tell us how it is, all right? Tell us.
Please.
Bob, all my best for sharing your story and such a sort of personal part of yourself. And all success with the book. I hope it encourages people.
Thanks so much, Seth.
Thank you so much for listening to the broadcast tonight. I will see you next Tuesday as we talk about the things that scare us, edging closer and closer to October the 31st, the Halloween holiday. Now that the show's over, don't forget to check out naturebox.com and sign up to get your free sampler box of great-tasting, healthy snacks. Forget the vending machine. You can snack smarter with delicious, tasty treats like banana bread granola. Go to naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. That's naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. And I'll see you next week.
Follow The Thinking Atheist on Facebook and Twitter. Watch dozens of original videos on The Thinking Atheist YouTube channel. And visit our website for resources, links, contact information, the editor's blog, and more. TheThinkingAtheist.com.